Can you hear me? Everything's working? Okay. Hope everybody had a nice lunch. Now, I'm trying to try very hard not to put you to sleep. It's going to be tough. But there's going to be important information at the beginning, in the middle, and the end. Okay? So hang in there. I've been in clinical practice in the Seattle area for about 12 years, and there are... Can you hear okay? In the back, can you turn me up a little? There are folks who can't hear. How's that? Okay. Wave to them if you can't hear me. I've been in practice about 12 years, and I don't have any magical answers, but at least my staff and I have been swinging away at this one for a long time, and we think we've got some things that are meaningful. Every single thing I'm going to tell you is off-label. None of this is approved by the FDA, but I'm going to give you data, scientific data. Some is stronger than others that has compelled me to think that this may be a reasonable way to go, but of course there are many choices with this disorder. I'm gonna really talk about a story. This is the story of my struggle with trying to help individuals for which my professors gave me no answers, and patients who just kept coming back and giving me another try and another try and another try, and it's really them that deserve the credit of hanging in there and ask me what else do you have that can make me sick. So all the credit goes to them. We're going to talk about some practical treatment options, things we actually do every day, things I'll be doing on Monday when I go back to work. Then I'm going to fill you in on dopamine receptors, and I tend to talk to my patients like they're colleagues, and sometimes we go over a couple of times, and sometimes we have handouts, but I try not to talk down to folks, but I may lose a few of you, but I want to give everybody a chance to know what the real science is here. And then finally, just a slide on the emerging theory that, at least for me and some other investigators, may be really tying together what we're talking about. As you all know, primary care physicians deal with a variety of things. And as rheumatologists, we thought we took care of most of the fatigue and pain and so forth. But in a primary care setting, trouble sleeping, 44% of the individuals would complain of that. Joint pain, about 34%. Back pain is very common. Fatigue, of course, 60% in this group. This is from Lee Smith, who's one of your own internists here. How common this is not really in question. This is another slide he shared with me. The most common musculoskeletal disorder is back and neck pain. And if you look at fibromyalgia based on the specific criteria of 18 tender points, or at least 11 of 18 tender points and so forth, the incidence is about 2,000 per 100,000. But it really is much higher than that if you really think of fibromyalgia as a concept of non-restorative sleep and amplified pain and fatigue. You don't have to have all the tender points every time. When I meet a new patient, sometimes I'm seeing them on a good day, and the next day they're obvious, and the day I saw them happened to be a day the tender points weren't as strong. So we know the incidence of fibromyalgia is very high, and there are probably at least 10 million Americans with this disorder. It's present worldwide. The problem with the research in fibromyalgia is we all look at it from our own perspective. The gastroenterologist is struggling with irritable bowel. The rheumatologist looks at the joints. The sleep experts look at the sleep. You know, you can see the pattern here. But what we're trying to do is look at a comprehensive explanation for why, how do you get the whole package? Why do some people have these associations with other problems in the bowels and palpitations and temperature regulation and sweat glands go crazy, in addition to what we call fibromyalgia? And my talk really today is going to be more on fibromyalgia than chronic fatigue, so I apologize to those individuals, but this is the area of my research. In 1990, we finally developed criteria at the American College of Rheumatology so we could at least pick individuals who we were absolutely sure had fibromyalgia so we could study it systematically. So if someone didn't get better on a therapy, it wasn't because we put them in a study with the wrong disease. And these are the three graces from the Louvre, and they illustrate the different tender points. And unfortunately, it's not at all fair to men. Men get fibromyalgia too, often misdiagnosed. For a man to get fibromyalgia tender points, it has to be exceptionally severe, whereas women will give us the clues a little earlier. But it can be seen in men, of course. It's not new. It's not something Newsweek just published 10 years ago. One of my favorite articles is from the British Journal of Medicine in 1902 when they coined the term fibrositis, and they described this disorder as the disease of the century. And it wasn't last century, it was the century before. In 1949, they came up with the term psychogenic rheumatism, a very tragic term that endorsed the psychiatrist's perception that this was a psychiatric disease. I'm a firm believer that although psychiatric concerns might affect the cause, it's definitely not a psychiatric process. Moldovsky gets the credit for calling it non-restorative sleep syndrome, and I'll go over his work today and tell you why I feel that that was one of the first breakthrough studies ever done. The nature of sleep is, and its benefits to our welfare is not new. In Elizabethan England, I share with you a quote from Macbeth. And Macbeth is probably the most violent and some ways depressing of all of Shakespeare's tragedies. Everyone dies in Macbeth. But with the guilt and so forth, Macbeth does murder sleep, the innocent sleep, the sleep that knits up the raveled sleeve of care. This is a very eloquent description of the value of restorative sleep. The death of each day's life, sore labor's bath, balm of hurt minds, great nature's second course, chief nourisher in life's feast. The answer to fibromyalgia is in Macbeth. And I'm convinced that sleep is a major component of this, and I'm going to give you the evidence of why I think so. Two pivotal studies have compelled me to go in this direction. First, Harvey Moldovsky. At the time, a bit of a renegade in 1975, a psychiatrist who didn't buy the idea that this was a psychiatric disease. He took college students, put them in a sleep laboratory. Of course, they were just starting to study sleep at the time. Hooked them to the EEG, played an irritating noise, computer-generated noise, as they were going from stage 1 and 2 sleep into stage 3 and 4 deep restful sleep. And it startled them into the light sleep stages, but he was careful not to wake them up. And as they tried to cycle back into deep sleep, he'd do it again. And he did this all night long. And he did this for 3 nights, and they all developed global pain, amplified tenderness throughout, and fatigue and muscular dysfunction. At the time, they didn't have the criteria for fibromyalgia, so it wasn't quite as clear what he caused. We now know that that certainly was fibromyalgia. Thankfully, when he stopped the study, it all reversed in about 3 days. His conclusions were that stage 4 sleep is required for certain homeostatic functions, certain functions that you need every day to maintain your well-being. He repeated the study, trying to disturb REM sleep. It didn't work. He repeated the study in high-level athletes. It didn't work. But we know from talking to unfortunate individuals who've been tortured by sleep deprivation that they've never heard of fibromyalgia, but they'll describe the feeling of sleep deprivation identical to fibromyalgia, and then some. If you continue to disturb sleep, you can actually make someone psychotic. And I am told that in 14 days you would actually die, although I don't know if there's a study to quote for that. So Moldovsky has this great breakthrough, and what happens? For the next 20 years, we try to give people medicines that induce sleep. Deep sleep, particularly. Does it work? Well, a few get better. Most don't. Most get weight gain and dry eyes and dry mouth on amitriptyline, and they try everything they can. And for the next 20 years, it gets fairly discouraging. And in 1997, John Russell, who's really another one of the pioneers of fibromyalgia research, repeats Moldovsky's study, and it doesn't work. Very interesting. If you look at his methods, they're different. Instead of playing an irritating, arousing, computer-generated noise like Moldovsky did, he allowed the subjects to pick a type of music that they might choose to wake up. It appears that the arousal, the type of arousal, is as important as its effect on deep sleep. Moldovsky's arousal was a startle reflex, was a fight-or-flight response, was a scary, frightening sound, not like music. The University of Washington, the nursing school, they repeated Moldovsky's study with his techniques in 40-year-old women, and it caused the same thing Moldovsky did. So we have a lot more confidence now that Moldovsky was right, but it is the arousal that is important. Now, Dr. Scharf, I think, showed you some EEG data. I just have one slide. This is a K-alpha wave complex. This is someone who's sleeping quietly, and as it's been described to me, you drop a book, hits the floor, you get one of these, then it settles down. It sounds to me like the startle reflex. When you play the noise that irritates and ruins the sleep, it's this. Since then, they've found there are many other kinds of ways of alpha wave intrusion, busyness, that deprive stage 4 sleep. But this is one we're all arguing about. What does it mean? Can we get rid of them? If we get rid of them, will we get stage 4 sleep back? If we get stage 4 sleep back, will we reverse fibromyalgia? The idea is, can we get rid of the arousal and then you sleep on your own? We don't want to try to make you sleep anymore. We want to try to let you sleep. Remove the barriers and the arousals that are causing sleep deprivation. Second big study of two. So there's not an endless list here. This is Muhammad Yunus, dedicated his life to studying fibromyalgia. He's in Illinois. And what he reported in 1996, which was very interesting to me, was that there was a higher incidence of restless leg syndrome in patients with fibromyalgia versus normal controls. Leg RLS here in green, 31% versus 2% of controls. Interesting to note that the RA patients had a little bit extra too, and that's another topic we won't get into today. So now we've got increased restless leg. What do we do with that? Well, restless leg options are very interesting, and they're varied. If you're magnesium or iron deficient, that can help. One of the reasons magnesium malate helps is, I don't believe it's the malate, it's the magnesium. And the problem with magnesium is if you check a blood level, you have to be 30% down in your total body magnesium to have it abnormal. It's an extremely insensitive test. So we don't know how many people are magnesium deficient. Anti-epileptics, such as Neurontin and other seizure medicines, Depakote and so forth, they treat restless leg. We also know they're called mood stabilizers, and they treat neuropathic pain, and they play a role in some people for fibromyalgia relief. The benzodiazepines, there are two. Valium, Xanax, they don't treat restless leg very well, but clonazepam and lorazepam do. Temazepam is a benzodiazepine used for sleep, and it has some effect. And then the most famous treatments for restless leg are the Parkinson's medications, carbidopa or Sinemet, and what are called the dopamine agonists. They are the second generation medications, very special for Parkinson's patients. They try to find safer treatments that would work. There are medicines that stimulate the dopamine receptor because the dopamine is not there. And that's the strategy to help those poor folks who have the movement disorders. So what we did is we were using our best options to try to help patients with fibromyalgia. Generally trazodone, we didn't have much else. It was the mid-1990s. We didn't want to use the amitriptyline and so forth. So we added a restless leg option, and we reported this at the American College of Rheumatology meeting. Now, the reason I did this is because although I was interested in helping the patients with fibromyalgia, most of my primary referral doctors were about to riot because they thought I was going to turn everybody into a junkie, that everybody get addicted to the benzodiazepines. So we reported on safety for a year, and then the next year we reported 3 years of safety. Did anybody abuse it? Did anybody get prescriptions early? Did anybody escalate the dose without permission? No. If anybody did, they did it a month. We asked them not to. They go back down. Patients with fibromyalgia categorically did not abuse medications. Individuals who have a tendency towards addiction might, and individuals who are injured and who need pain medications and the dose is inadequate, that's called pseudo-addiction. That's not even addiction. So, one, we reported this to show that in 2 weeks, 82% of the subjects improved by adding lorazepam, and 50% were pain-free, but we undoubtedly had a fairly significant placebo response too, because we know that that's not the ultimate answer. But what we did notice is that the safety was excellent, and we reported that. The dopamine family of receptors was discovered in trying to find a safer treatment for Parkinson's disease. Now, you've heard plenty of discussions on serotonin, maybe norepinephrine, maybe dopamine, but we are at the next level. We're not talking about the neurotransmitter level. We're talking about the actual different receptors that do different things, even though they're all stimulated by dopamine. What they uncovered is that there are two families based on what the cell does when the receptor is stimulated. There's a D1 and a D2 family, and in the D2 family, there are three identified, of which D3 is the focus that I'm going to talk about. Antipsychotics work by inhibiting D2. The restless leg syndrome is treated by the D2 stimulants or agonists. The first D2 agonists stimulated all these. The new ones stimulate just this. And that is where we're learning something. Pramipexol is one of the two dopamine 3 receptor agonists developed for Parkinson's disease and FDA approved in 1997. As I said, they hit a home run for safety with this drug. It's not that great a Parkinson's treatment, but it's a remarkable safety advance. It's renally metabolized, goes right out the urine. It does not have drug interactions except with high-dose Sinemet, which is hallucinations, and we don't put patients with fibromyalgia on Sinemet. Less nausea and dizziness. It turns out in the studies we've done, none of the Parkinson's side effects. So if you look it up at the pharmacy, they will not be able to give you data on fibromyalgia patients. But that data does exist, and I can tell you where it is. But in terms of a safer medicine, it was a great advance, at least for Parkinson's patients. And its most common use now is in restless leg if you go to a sleep expert in low doses. So we saw this in 1998, and we're going along the line of a restless leg idea. And we said, well, okay, here's the latest, greatest for restless leg. Mayo Clinic reported that. When nothing else worked, this did. So we looked at this, and we gently added it to our most severe patients, and we let them increase as they wished at their own pace, and they reported it in 166 consecutive patients over an average of 4 months. These individuals had severe fibromyalgia. They had taken 6 medicines for fibromyalgia. They'd seen an average of 5.76 physicians just for fibromyalgia, and they had a very high pain score, which I'll define in just a second. The pain score we're using is a score that's very different than what you may have heard of. We're not counting tender points. We look at each of the 18 tender points, but we score each one accordingly. No pain at all is a zero, and that's got to be no pain with pretty firm palpation. Trace would be slight pain with firm palpation. A 1+ is the usual. Maybe it's dying a bit. 1+ is the usual 4-kilogram pressure. And 4 kilograms is if you push your thumb and you blanch your fingernail. If you do that, you'll notice that's very light. That's 4 kilograms. 2+, we wanted a designation for that severe withdrawal pain. And then 3+, exquisite. I wanted to differentiate if we could take a person with exquisite horrible fibromyalgia and make it moderate, or if we could take a mild or moderate and make it really zero. So zero is zero, okay? This is what we had. The original pain score was 24.5, and it was cut in half. Again, open label, no placebo yet. Average dose was 1.55 milligrams. There was a spread on there. And that's the highest dose for Parkinson's disease. The dose for restless leg is about a quarter of that. And here's how they stacked up. 30% were pain-free, 43% were well, and we define that as less than 4 points. That's just maybe 4 tender points, and the rest is fine. 3/4 improved, 20% were the same, 4% were worse. But we need to look at safety. We have a very sensitive group here, which I'm sure you all know. And at least in this group, the main problem was a stimulatory response in about 8%, that paradoxical response, where you take something like Tylenol PM and you're up all night. You know, it doesn't do that. But the reason you feel that is actually part of the arousal and the sympathetic overactivity that underlies this sleep deprivation issue, the thing that causes that arousal, the thing that causes that K-alpha wave complex. So what happened is we gave them the medicine, and it kind of backfired, and that system took off on them. Over 70% really didn't have any significant adverse events that they wanted to tell us about, and nausea popped up here. We know now more about this profile, and we know nausea is the main issue. And it's... we have a strategy to block it, but we know what's going on there. We know that you can never start a dopamine agonist for fibromyalgia without blocking acid production in the stomach. We learned this the hard way, but we finally learned it. We looked at 90 consecutive patients who started pramipexol, increasing slowly at bedtime every week. I mean, it's a very slow titration. And we put everybody on proton pump inhibitors, 3 at bedtime for 1 night. And we gave them samples of all 4, and then we asked them, how you doing? And we checked them at 2 months, and here's what we found. We found that these are success rates, and success means you call back and say, I might have had some nausea, but this controls it. I can take the pramipexol. I just happen to take these acid blockers, I'm fine. And so we could never predict which one anybody liked. So we always give you all four. At least you take one for each day and then you just tell us what you think. 25% had no nausea at all. We don't know why they didn't have any nausea. But we know that this is probably the brainstem resisting. The medicine is too low to help, but it's enough to irritate the brainstem. This is a regulatory function. It fights back. And the way it fights back is it increases autonomic control of the stomach, and usually it's acid. That's the most common description. At the end of 2 months, though, only 15% of people were still taking the proton pump inhibitor. So it's very temporary. It's when you're increasing the dose. Once you increase the dose to the therapeutic level, we don't see the intolerance, which is very interesting because as doctors, we don't see medications have less side effects at higher doses very often, but this is one of them. So then we had to go to the next step. Let's do it at different offices. Let's make sure it's not just me. The biggest criticism I got from my former professors was I was a nice guy and I cared a lot and my patients could feel that and it was, they just wanted to tell me they were doing well. It was about as insulting as you could get, especially if you were trying to intellectually, be a good doctor. I mean, I was complimented, but not really. So what we did is I found some very thoughtful, kind doctors who were interested, and then we put them on the same protocol, increasing the pramipexole 0.25 milligram every week over 8 weeks to 2 milligrams. But this time we used more sophisticated measures than just that tender point score. We looked at function, fatigue, a global score, pain score. The group is what you might expect. Average 48 years. This is all women in this group. We used mostly people from the other offices. I only put 3 of my own people in here. I didn't want to skew the data. It used an average of six medications, seen 3 doctors. We tried to exclude folks with chronic narcotics because we're just trying to keep it clean and simple. We wanted to exclude sleep apnea, bipolar, and psychosis. Again, try to focus on fibromyalgia just as a pilot. Unfortunately, the average weight was 190 pounds up to 304, and I don't think they excluded bipolar very well. So we got a bunch of folks with sleep apnea very well. We've got a bunch of folks in here with sleep apnea, and sleep apnea is a critical thing in fibromyalgia. I'll explain that in a little bit. So here's what happened. 40 were screened, 20 were eligible, 22 started the study. At 1 month, we saw how they were doing, and only 2 had dropped out, 1 for insomnia, pretty much didn't work, and 1 for nausea. And then by month 2, we got 14 to the full dose, and we lost some more. Dizziness, nausea, shortness of breath, constipation, and cough. Just kind of how it worked out. What we found, though, even though we had the dropouts, is the average pain score went from 20 to 15 to 11, and it was statistically significant even though we'd lost all those patients. So again, we had some encouragement that maybe this non-sedating medicine that treats Parkinson's has no psychiatric effect, no analgesic effect, no known sleep effect. It's not sedating. It's a daytime medicine, but it does treat arousal very, very well. That maybe we were letting patients sleep, maybe we were making progress with this idea, and maybe we should keep working on it. This is a very busy slide. I just want you to look here at the p-value. Everything is statistically significant in function, psychiatric, pain, stiffness, fatigue, global, and really the next picture is a little more illustrative. That is the graph. Never in my career have I seen this kind of a thing where you drop this far. The average response for any drug ever reported for fibromyalgia is a mean response of 35%. There are no studies that show a mean response of 60, 70%. There aren't any. Limitations of this data, however, is this is an open label study. Again, no one's on the placebo here. So we have to take this with a grain of salt. So it's encouraging. The safety looks good, but you need the big study. Well, obviously I'm here to tell you about the big study. This was a side effect profile. We had insomnia where it just didn't work, nausea, shortness of breath, dry eyes, dry mouth, and anxiety. Nothing very serious. Things that are very common in fibromyalgia. Things we're trying to find a strategy to figure out what made these people special and what can we do about it. We also looked to see, could we predict who might drop out, who might have side effects? Was it based on your age or how long you had fibromyalgia or how much pain you had? No, nothing predicted it. We weren't able to tell going in who was going to tolerate and who wouldn't. The next step was to look at safety because we started talking to the FDA about this drug. The FDA had no safety data whatsoever over 1.5 milligrams at bedtime. Well, the last study went to 2 milligrams. we've been using in the meantime, and we know that the therapeutic dose is 4.5 milligrams. And some pain patients who were referred to me because they had fibromyalgia with pain from an injury per se, we had pushed the dose up to 10 milligrams, so 10 times what the FDA had. So to get the FDA even to consider approving a study, because you can't do a study just because you want to and have the funding. You have to get approval from the FDA. It has to be safe, and that's part of their job. So what we did is we looked at the charts, and we looked at patients just in the practice who were on 2.25 to 10 milligrams at bedtime. These are huge doses relative to what a neurologist would tell you about. The average Parkinson's dose is 0.5. Okay? Here's what we found. In 8 months, the average use was 8 months, only 12.8% discontinued for any reason, which is very unusual. More than 12% of people taking Tylenol discontinue it. I mean, you don't have a drug in the practice that people don't discontinue more than 8% or 12% in 8 months. It just doesn't exist. And it doesn't mean that people didn't have side effects. What they meant is, what they thought was the drug helped them enough that they did not want to stop it. And it was discontinued for ineffectiveness, an adverse event, and for cost. And the side effect profiles for discontinuation was nausea mostly, sometimes sleepiness. We now know that that's untreated sleep apnea. And then just a smattering of other things. It was this data that allowed the FDA to approve the study we just finished, or just about to finish. Now, at the same time, there's a second one. I'd never heard of it. It's called Rapinrol, or Requip. You may have heard of it. It's used for restless leg. It's just like pramipexole, except it's liver metabolized. And it's used mostly in Europe, but it's available in the U.S. So when the Mirapex didn't work, we tried the Requip, or the Rapinrol. And these poor individuals had a remarkable constellation of awful problems. 63% had severe clinical depression on many medications seeing a psychiatrist. 53 had ongoing severe spine pain. We're talking about radiculopathy, spinal stenosis, not just back pain. 32% had sleep apnea, 26% had severe bipolar disorder, 47% were already disabled, 21% were applying for disability. This is the pain score difference in 4 months. Went from 22 to 9. This is the most challenging group of folks I've ever met, probably the most courageous individuals I know. And what we found is that we're making some kind of difference here. Again, open label, preliminary, you've got to do a real study, but encouraging. What we found is if you took the drug, you start 100% of people are on the drug, and this is the discontinuation rate. So at 5 months, about 50% have discontinued, but look what happens. If it helps you, you stay on it. It has staying power. It doesn't run out of steam. Question is, how do we get things to work in every person? This is side effect profile, agitation. Not uncommon for any medicine with fibromyalgia, I'm afraid. Worsening depression, nausea again, some dizziness, nightmares. Interesting thing, no hypotension. No sleep attacks. That's what's described with these medicines in Parkinson's patients. Completely different safety profile in patients with fibromyalgia. You'd think that patients with fibromyalgia would be more sensitive. No. They tolerate it much, much better, and the higher the dose, the better they tolerate it. Interesting thing, 13 of 19 people discontinued, and that would be a major criticism in that, you know, two-thirds of the people didn't stay on it, but of those 13, 11 had noted improved pain. So they discontinued for a variety of reasons, but it wasn't because it didn't help them. So what happened next, thankfully, is the manufacturer of Rapinrol or Requip said, this is interesting, we'd like to study it. And we did a study approved by the FDA in 30 patients, an exploratory study, looking at very sophisticated tools, saw folks every single week for 14 weeks, 20 on active drug, 10 on placebo, and that was just presented in Edinburgh 2 weeks ago. So I can share some of the data with you, the publication's not out yet. We did not achieve statistical significance, which is too bad, but every single parameter of measurement had a positive trend. Enough so that the manufacturer is doing a study in 300 patients in Europe starting October. This is in red, the placebo group, and this is on the side pain on a visual analog score, like you 0 to 10 centimeters and you put your line somewhere. Right? And basically we had a little bit of placebo response through here, and the yellow is the active drug, decreasing from 7 down to about 4.5. This is a different type of pain score, just 0 to 11. It actually makes a difference the way you ask the question. If you put a line across, or if you just circle numbers, apparently. So we looked at both. In this, the Requip or Rapinrol was actually started much higher than this. So even though you follow this down, it's not much lower. This one started lower and ended up higher. So this was actually very encouraging to the manufacturer. Now, all the psychiatrists, what do they say when you have a patient who got better on a SSRI, they got better on amitriptyline? What do they say? It's a psychiatric problem. See? This has no psychiatric issues. And in fact, we measured the Hamilton depression score. It didn't do anything. This is not a psychiatric-based process. Now, what I suspect is if we can do larger studies and really get an answer for folks that if they don't have pain, they're not going to be depressed. But what the message here is that we're not really treating a psychiatric process. We're treating a pain perception electrical process in the brain that's caused by lack of stage 4 sleep. And it's probably the arousal that ruins the sleep, and it's the dopamine 3 receptor which controls that arousal. That's probably how it goes.
Mm-hmm. And the doctor tries to give you stuff to help you sleep.
Mm-hmm.
But you know your fibromyalgia is really the one that's hard to differentiate between the both.
That's our job, yeah, right.
Yeah, so how do we get our professionals to understand that?
Oh, talk to the rheumatologist has to teach. I teach patients, I teach the referring docs. But I'm going to take questions at the end, but that's how we have to do it. That's more of a logistical problem. What we try to do is we just try to get you better, and then the psychiatrist call me and say, what'd you do for the bipolar? It looks so much better. And dopamine agonists anecdotally have been reported as treating bipolar disorder. So it won't be their main treatment, but it may be part of what they do. Now, this is a very important slide. It's very important that nobody goes to their doctor on Monday and say, put me on these drugs. Because, one, they're off-label and you have to know what you're doing. Number two is no one should ever start these medicines without a proton pump inhibitor. It's just silly. Now, 25% of folks don't have nausea and it works out fine. But 75% will get sick or have morning sickness kind of feeling and they'll think it's a lousy idea and they'll never get to the therapeutic dose and they'll look for something else. And heaven knows I'm looking too and I haven't found much else. So it's very important you don't burn any bridges. It's very important to control intolerance. The proton pump inhibitors, we use them for a week. If you don't need them, fine. But everybody starts at 3 at bedtime. The maximum dose is 6 in the PDR. So we're not pushing the dose in terms of safety. But 3 is what's required because the sympathetic stimulation from the autonomic nervous system to the stomach is greater in folks with fibromyalgia because they have abnormal sympathetic arousal in the first place. The next thing is we use still that old-fashioned lorazepam and clonazepam for the folks who are in terrible distress because these medicines don't work very fast. It takes a long time to get the dose right. And we know we can treat some of the arousal with the old restless leg treatment with clonazepam and lorazepam in those low doses at bedtime. And the study before demonstrated that folks with fibromyalgia do not abuse it and it provides a partial benefit rapidly. So at least there's some hope there. So it's not hard to get the help you want. It's just important that your doctors have a chance to catch up with what you're learning right now. And the papers that are being written won't really be at press for a year. You know. So that information can be shared, but it's hard for them. They can't go to the internet and look this up yet. The other thing is very important to realize that we're talking about a sympathetic arousal that ruins sleep. What if you have another sympathetic arousal? Well, that's going to block the treatment if you're going this direction. What are the two most common sympathetic arousals that, as physicians, we don't recognize very well? Sleep apnea. 35% of my patients have sleep apnea. If they don't tolerate the dopamine agonist, they call back in a week and say, hey, I can't take this little tiny dose with any of those acid blockers. Stop immediately, get a sleep study. 90%+ have sleep apnea. Treat the sleep apnea, control that particular arousal, you're back on board. You have a chance to respond to the medicine. So it's very important not to miss who they are because there's an awful lot of people. And the regular risk factors of morning somnolence, sleepy driving a car, morning headaches, snoring heavily, they're important, but they don't matter. We have folks who don't have any of those. They're 90 pounds soaking wet, they're 80 years old, and they have severe sleep apnea. And the reason we knew it We couldn't fix their fibromyalgia. We couldn't seem to get rid of that arousal. We couldn't turn it off. They never got their sleep quality back with everything we tried. So it's very, very important that your doctors realize that they have to work with a sleep lab sometimes. It's a serious issue. You have to sleep normally to beat this. The other one is cervical myelopathy, an emerging concept where individuals have pain with extension. We ask every single person, what does it feel like to sit in a dentist chair with your neck back for a long time? What does it feel like to go to the hairdresser? If the answer is yes, we get a new, more modern MRI where we look at for compression of the cord with your neck back. If you do, we have to take care of that. That doesn't have to be a make or break problem, and it's often not surgery, but you got to know that that hides. So it's a little more complicated than just, you know, take the latest, greatest, and get better. Everybody knew this was going to be complicated. But the strategy is to try to control this arousal and then to sleep on your own. Basically, this is the pramipexol study. It's a double-blind, placebo-controlled trial. 50 of the 60 patients have already finished, and we'll finish it up by the end of the month. We're hoping to have it at the national meeting this year. It's the primary endpoint is the same, that visual analog score, VAS score, 10 millimeters of pain, the improvement. But for the first time in history, one of the outcome measures for this is heart rate variability. That is a validated tool that measures sympathetic activity in Olympic athletes, astronauts, and cardiology patients. This is a technology that has existed for 20 years, but it's never really been shared with the medical community. You can actually measure sympathetic activity with this. So that'll be very exciting to see if we see improvement match the sympathetic changes. So this is probably the most important slide in terms of what works. Now, these are just medications. The other ideas with massage and acupuncture and so forth, I have to leave to other specialties. But we judge a medicine in fibromyalgia by this criteria. How many people achieve more than 50% improvement in pain? How many people? With the original lorazepam study, 54% achieved that. That was no placebo, so we don't have that here. So again, this is you got to look at this with a grain of salt. The first pramipexol study where they got to go to the dose they wanted to, 58% achieved that. The next one where they did pramipexol at the three different offices, 54%. Those poor folks that had all the back pain and all those terrible things with their fibromyalgia and didn't respond to the Mirapex, 74%. Now remember, a lot of them quit it, but that still was the number. This is pregabalin. Pregabalin should be available later this year. Its first indication will probably be neuropathic pain by Pfizer. It was the largest blinded fibromyalgia study ever done. 528 patients reported in 2002. The folks on the drug, 29% achieved that greater than 50% reduction in pain. Placebo group, 11% do. There's always folks in the placebo group that will get better. This is a misprint, 4.5, it's really 450. Milnacipram is the effector-like drug that affects norepinephrine and serotonin that Cypress Biosciences dedicated really their entire company to solving the fibromyalgia problem, and they're in phase 3 trials. This is their phase 2 data, and 37% of the folks on that drug achieved greater than 50% reduction of pain. And the placebo group was a little high at 14. The ropinirole group that we just presented in Edinburgh, 45% achieved that reduction in pain, and 30% in the placebo. This is a very high placebo response rate, and the reason is very simple. The study was completed during the summer last year. We had the best summer in Seattle we've had in 30 years. We had no rain for 4 months. It's unbelievable how good people felt considering what we live with. The day you have outside, we'll get one in August and maybe a couple in September, and then we're back to gray again. So it's very different living here and there. And then the pramipexol, this is the preliminary data numbers that we have so far, but these will change when we get the last 10 people done. So in terms of, does it look like it's worth pursuing this line of reasoning? Is it worth considering something out of left field for Parkinson's that by accident treats restless leg, that by accident affects one receptor, which seems to control arousal that ruins the sleep? Yeah, it does look like it's reasonable to do that. Basically, to sum up how I put this together, and I'm leaving lots of time, if I can, for questions, is basically, this is an autonomic issue. The autonomic nervous system controls a variety of housekeeping functions. It has to work right. It's combined with your endocrine system to manage your how you handle stresses, interior stresses, exterior stresses, infections, how you make it. And it controls many things: temperature regulation, sweat glands, heart rate, blood pressure, stomach acid production, bowel motility, metabolic rate, has effects on the immune system. Basically, it has to work. If it doesn't work, you're going to run into a lot of different problems. It's associated, its abnormality and overactivity is associated with hypermobility syndrome. And there's been a lot of interesting information on hypermobility and fibromyalgia. Hypermobile individuals comprise 20% of the population, and they simply have a little bit looser ligaments. It's not a disease, it's a trait. But they tend to get kneecap pain, go up and down stairs, flat feet, plantar fasciitis, unexplained chest pains, mitral valve prolapse. We don't think that's directly related to fibromyalgia, but its association with autonomic activity is an issue. So when the autonomic nervous system is misbehaving, you crank up the stomach acid, you get reflux, you get irritable bowel syndrome. You get what's called vasomotor instability, where your control of all your blood vessels and capillaries and your temperature goes crazy and your sweat glands don't work right. You get stimulatory states, panic disorder. What is a panic attack? It's a fight or flight response, a sympathetic epinephrine response at the wrong time. These things are supposed to turn on when you need them, not in the middle of the grocery store. Bipolar disorder swings up and down. That stimulatory phase may certainly be related to the stimulatory nature of this regulatory function. Post-traumatic stress disorder, well, there isn't a greater fight or flight response that's poorly regulated than that. That's a fear and activity that should occur only in the setting of fear that just persists and turns out at the wrong time. Palpitations, it's epinephrine. Unexplained chest pains, you treat it with Ativan and lorazepam, which controls sympathetic activity. It's an old ER trick. ADHD, all the treatments are related to dopamine, and it's remarkable how many mothers I take care of with children with ADHD, and some of them are actually using Pramipexole now. So the way I look at this is that the autonomic dysregulation inhibits the stage four sleep. It expressed during the day as sort of a multitasking, thoughtful, go, 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 talk fast like me kind of thing. But when it's on at night, it shows up as racing thoughts, disruptive dreams, grinding teeth, restless leg syndrome. And it potently inhibits stage four sleep, which if you lose stage four sleep, you get fibromyalgia. If you get a little of this, you get fatigue and you go to Starbucks every day. If you get more, you ache all over and wonder why. If you get a little more, your whole body falls apart. So the idea is to stop this process right at the heart, right there. And so, again, we don't try to make you sleep. We try to let you sleep. Control the arousal. Understand what other autonomic arousals you have. The drowning reflex of sleep apnea can never be missed. Compression of the cervical cord is an autonomic arousal, proven in rats, I'm afraid. So very important stuff. This I'll probably skip because it's a little confusing for everybody. But I want to pull together one final thing. A month ago, the final piece of this story came out in a journal called Medical Hypotheses. A guy at LSU was talking about dopamine 2 receptors and chronic widespread pain. That's the term they use for fibromyalgia in Europe. And I called him because we have a problem with this whole theory. Dopamine 3 receptor medicines work very well for many people with this disorder. They stimulate one receptor, the dopamine 3 receptor. That's well worked out. The sympathetic nervous systems in the brainstem, that pacemaker busy activity that drives the whole arousal, there are no dopamine 3 receptors there. So if this medicine works, how, and we think it's controlling arousal, how could that be? There's no way for it to act there. He told me. The stimulatory centers in the brainstem that start the activity when the lion jumps out from behind the tree. Okay? Those fibers have to go through the mesolimbic area where the inhibitory neurons are. Okay, it's a balance. There's a yin-yang, right? What he says is the accelerator works, the brake is broken. What happens is the inhibitory neurons are full of dopamine 3 receptors. He proposes that what we're doing is we're stimulating those receptors so that we increase the inhibitory balance. So we bring the inhibition up to the stimulation and we get a net zero. If you get a net zero, you turn off the stimulation. And that's what they're thinking. I want to leave you with, before I take questions, I'll leave you with something positive, because it's a rough day and you've all been very patient. most people know the first line of this, but they may not know the other line. And some people look at Ard and Renoir and Rubens, who had rheumatoid arthritis, and it's fascinating how their painting changed when they developed the diseases, and there's some wonderful rheumatologists to talk about. But I'm kind of interested more in literature and fibromyalgia and sleep. So obviously Macbeth was of interest to me when I heard it. This is John Keats, famous British poet. "A thing of beauty is a joy forever. Its loveliness increases. It will never pass into nothingness, but still will keep a bower quiet for us and a sleep full of sweet dreams and health and quiet breathing." So even then, you know, they know where the action is. They know where the target is. So as physicians, we haven't really known how to or, you know, really go after this problem. But right now, I can assure you that there are centers that are not just trying to make you feel better. They're trying to find the cause and go after the biochemical cause of this so you can actually get your lives back. So I don't know when it'll happen, but at least there's plenty of effort. So I appreciate your time and patience, and I'm happy to take some questions.